Good morning. I'm Judy Zerubik, a member of King Cardon United Church and the previous minister here at King Cardon United. I am offering leadership during this service while Gord Dunbar continues a well-deserved vacation time. I welcome all who are joining us on live streaming with Zoom and those who are watching later on YouTube or our church webpage or on Rogers Cable TV. Since we have not opened for in-person worship, many of you are still taped to the pews. We thought maybe we might move them around just to confuse you as to where you were going to sit. I would like to thank those who have made this service possible. David Hamilton on the organ, and Dave, Liz, and Rod providing hymn leadership and the anthem today. Sarah McKenzie, who prepared PowerPoint slides. Mary and John Phillips, who are our tech support today. Liz Dillman, our treasurer, and John Phillips, our envelope steward. Without any of them, we would not be able to offer this worship to you today. So thank you to each one of you. Thank you, thank you, thank you. Here in King Cardon, we use the screens a lot. And when you see red print in bold, that's for the worship leader, me today, and the black bold print is for the rest of you. Dave, Liz, and Rod will be doing that here, and I invite you to do it where you are for your space, joining us in your speaking part. So let's begin with the acknowledgement of the land. For thousands of years, First Nations people have walked this land, weaving their identity and their spirituality intimately with the land.
European colonization came about in large part because of the doctrine of discovery, a flawed understanding that ignores Indigenous presence on the land.
Affirming the United Nations Declaration of the Rights of Indigenous Peoples, and therefore repudiating the wrong of such a doctrine, we begin our worship this morning by acknowledging the unceded territory of the Saugeen Ojibwe.
We are all treaty people, parties to the Upper Treaty 45 and a half in 1836.
Keep us mindful of the covenants that have been made and broken with First Nations peoples.
May we grow into living with respect on this land, walking into reconciliation through peace and friendship, while honoring all who live, work, and worship on it.
I have a couple of announcements that I would like to highlight. First of all, woohoo! The refugees family has finally arrived. So let's hear it. Woohoo! Woo! So they fled Syria 7 years ago, and they've been in a refugee camp in Lebanon for 6 years, and they have arrived. The committee that is looking after the refugee family is looking for donations that can be made to King Cardon United Church with the memo line refugee family, and then we will send the donations to the refugee steering committee to use to pay their rent and to cover future costs of health care medications and other such things. So look in your hearts and see if that's something you're called to do. Also announcement, there is an internment service for Glenn Holmes this Saturday at the 19th at 3 p.m. You have to wear your masks, and you also have to phone David Linklater Funeral Home to let them know that you're interested in attending, because if you show up without them knowing, they may have to turn you away because of the public health demands that they have to enforce. So. Also, next Sunday is the Mission Sunday, September the 20th, and we are having Tom Franklin come as a guest speaker or send his meditation to us, and we will therefore send it to you. So he's going to look at the history of the future, and there's future needs that they need for seed and pest control, etc. So if you are able and willing, please send a donation and then memo line put Chalmers Community Garden, and we will make sure it gets to them. Fireside chats. I know some of you have been really missing them. Gord will return on Tuesday, September the 22nd for a fireside chat from his kitchen with some humor, sometimes more humor than needed, a reflection, some music, a prayer, and a blessing. So look forward to that on the 22nd. And the UCW is, so this is for any woman in the church. They are going to be having a virtual gathering. Their theme, A Step Forward, and it will be on Saturday, October the 3rd at 10 a.m. And there'll be more information sent out as to how to get on the visual gathering, etc. So put that in your date book so that you can make yourself available to attend that. So as the church has done for the millennia, let us greet each other with the peace of Christ, no matter where you are. If you are by yourself, just throw it out to the universe. If you are with someone, please join in the passing of the peace. So may the peace of Christ be with you all.
And also with you.
Let us now take time to prepare ourselves for worship by opening our hearts and our minds, stilling our bodies, and breathing slowly and deeply as we listen to the musical offering. All creation is made of star stuff. From the basic building blocks of the universe come fire, air, earth, and water.
And all creation sings praise to the creator of all.
Baptized by the waters of the sky, standing firm on the earth, breathing deep the breath of life, warmed by this flame.
We go where Christ's light shines. Alleluia! Alleluia! Amen.
Let us join in our call to worship. Be still and know that God is.
Before creation began, God was.
And when all human striving has ceased, God will still be.
From everlasting to everlasting, God is God, who alone is worthy to be worshipped.
Let us join in prayer to our God. Spirit, life, and soul of all creation, in moments of change, when everything we know starts to fade away, and yet before we know what is coming,
bless us with confidence in your wisdom and guidance.
Remind us of the glory of the earth as the leaves begin to change.
Help us to let go of what is no longer needed.
Free us from holding tightly to old ways and habits when your spirit calls us to a new day and a new way in creation.
We pray in the name of Jesus, who shows us the way. Amen.
We're going to join together in song now with Touch the Earth Lightly. And I'm going to move down further.
Give the great wonder, ours to sorrow.
Now our assurance of grace and prayer of confession. God knows how great our needs are. In these difficult times when families are experiencing great stress, God comes and brings healing. He brings healing love to us. When we place our trust in God, our lives will be transformed. Not just with healing, but with a spirit of hope and a spirit of compassion. Our past is behind us. We are free to live new lives, be new people, to try again to be who God intends us to be. God hears our cries and answers them. Let us pray. We confess, O God, that we have people in our lives with whom we struggle, carrying resentments for past hurts and injuries. And while we are eager to accept your love and forgiveness, our memories are short when it comes to giving love and forgiveness to others. Forgive us, God. Help us to give to each other that which you have freely and generously given to us. Amen. So we have not yet opened for in-person worship. Although we do have a plan in place for when we're able to open, I know that there are other churches in the area who are already opened for worship, but the church council at our last meeting decided to err on the side of safety and wait to see what kind of impact the reopening of schools has on our community, both here in the church community and in our wider community. The council did not want to open only to have to close again and thereby putting our members at risk. One of the protocols that we are seeing across our community is the wearing of masks, both for young and old. Well, there are wild debates happening all over the world as to whether this is a good thing or not. Personally, I'd rather share on the hoping it's a good thing. Our moderator, Richard Bott, has written a prayer that can be shared under the Creative Commons license for when we put on our mask. So think of this when you put on your mask. Creator, as I prepare to go into the world, help me to see the sacrament in the wearing of this cloth. Let it be an outward sign of an inward grace, a tangible and visible way of living love for my neighbors as I love myself. Christ, since my lips will be covered, uncover my heart, that people would see my smile in the wrinkles around my eyes. Since my voice may be muffled, help me to speak clearly, not only with my words, but with my actions. Holy Spirit, as the elastic touches my ears, remind me to listen carefully and full of care to all those I meet. May this simple piece of cloth be shield and banner, and each breath that it holds be filled with your love. In your name and in that love, I pray, may it be so. May it be so. So I would invite you to join with me in the Lord's Prayer. It's a translation found in Voices United. Our Father, Mother, who is in the heavens, may you be made holy. May your dominion come. May your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us today the bread we need, and forgive us our debts as we have forgiven our debtors. And do not put us to the test, but rescue us from evil. For yours is the dominion and the power and the glory forever. Amen.
The first scripture is the Hebrew scripture, Genesis 50, verses 15 to 21. Joseph forgives his brothers. Realizing that their father was dead, Joseph's brothers said, "What if Jesus still bears a grudge against us and pays us back in full for all the wrong that we did to him?" So they approached Joseph, saying, "Your father gave this instruction before he died. Say to Joseph, I beg you, forgive the crime of your brothers and the wrong they did in harming you. Now, therefore, please forgive the crime of the servants of the God of your father." Joseph wept when they spoke to him. When his brothers also wept, fell down before him and said, "We are here as your slaves." But Joseph said to them, "Do not be afraid. I am in the place of God. Even though you intended to do harm to me, God intended it for good, in order to preserve a numerous people as he is doing today. Even though you intended to do harm to me, God intended it for good, in order to preserve a numerous people as he is doing today. So have no fear. I myself will provide for you and your little ones." In this way, he reassured them, speaking kindly to them.
We'll now sing, "Forgive Our Sins as We Forgive."
The Gospel lesson is Matthew 18, verses 21 to 35, a story about forgiveness. At that point, Peter got up the nerve to ask, "Master, how many times do I forgive a brother or sister who hurts me? Seven?" Jesus replied, "Seven? Hardly. Try 70 times seven." The kingdom of God is like a king who decided to square accounts with his servants. As he got underway, one servant was brought before him who had run up a debt of $100,000. He couldn't pay up, so the king ordered the man, along with his wife, children, and goods, to be auctioned off at the slave market. The poor wretch threw himself at the king's feet and begged, "Give me a chance and I'll pay it all back." Touched by his plea, the king let him off, erasing the debt. The servant was no sooner out of the room when he came upon one of his fellow servants who owed him $10. He seized him by the throat and demanded, "Pay up now." The poor wretch threw himself. The poor wretch threw himself down and begged, "Give me a chance and I'll pay it all back." But he wouldn't do it. He had him arrested and put in jail until the debt was paid. When the other servants saw this going on, they were outraged and brought a detailed report to the king. The king summoned the man and said, "You evil servant, I forgave your entire debt when you begged me for mercy. Shouldn't you be compelled to be merciful to your fellow servant who asked for mercy?" The king was furious and put the screws to the man until he paid back his entire debt. And that's exactly what my Father in heaven is going to do to each one of you who doesn't forgive unconditionally anyone who asks for mercy.
Let us pray. May the words of my mouth and the meditations of each of our hearts be acceptable to you, O God, our strength and our Redeemer. Amen. I'm sorry. I had to stop for a drink. I'm sorry and A are what Canadians are known for. Are we not, A? Some comedians use these words in their acts. We laugh about the fact that we say sorry a lot. I say sorry when I bump into you, and I say sorry when you bump into me. Who is at fault doesn't seem really to matter. Writer Emily Keeler writes that her favorite, absolute favorite example of a Canadian apology is when you're out for a meal. Imagine it, you're out for a meal at a restaurant. What a novel idea. And you really need some ketchup. So you say to the waiter, whose job it is to help you get the things that you need to enjoy your meal, you say, I'm sorry, hi, is it okay if, well, could I have some ketchup, please? Oh, thanks. So sorry. She writes that this doesn't really make any sense. You could just say, excuse me, do you have any ketchup? How many of you may relate to this? I know I do. I don't use ketchup very much, but I do remember apologizing to a waitress saying, I'm sorry, but could you please bring me a knife and a fork so that I could eat my dinner? And she replied, sorry, and brought me the utensils, and I responded with, oh, so sorry, thanks. Canadian, right? Emily Keeler also tells a story about when she was riding her bike to work and she almost got hit by a truck. She could literally feel the whoosh of air as the truck went by. And the driver rolled down his window, probably to yell something like, sorry, I didn't see you, or get off the road. But before he could even get the chance to speak, she was already screaming, sorry, at the top of her lungs, even though she was in the bike path. Candace Walsh writes that asking for directions is another necessary evil. She remembers being in Montenegro and needing directions to her hostel. She asked a bored waiter who was leaning outside on the wall outside of the cafe about how to get there. And she said, sorry, can you tell me how to get to Backpacker's House? And she said, the waiter's face broke out in a grin and he said, you're Canadian, right? And then he led her directly to them through the maze of streets to her hostel. Or maybe you're walking down the street behind a person just minding his or her business, and then a piece of paper or a wallet or even something insignificant drops out of their pocket. You retrieve it quickly from the ground and rush up to the person, tapping them on the shoulder and say, sorry, mister, you dropped your wallet. As if you needed to apologize for not robbing them blind or simply ignoring the dropped objects. A woman from Victoria relates a story that she was shopping one day and accidentally backed into a mannequin. And as she was turning around, she was already apologizing, only to find out that she had bumped into a mannequin. So, being Canadian, she apologized to the mannequin for apologizing to a mannequin. And I'm sure all of you can relate similar stories. Well, I did when I was looking for some of these ideas, I found a story that made me shake my head. The story was reported on CBC in 2013. It's a very bizarre story, I must say. The story goes like this. A 44-year-old man in Winnipeg tried to rob a gas bar about 2 o'clock in the morning. He told the clerk that he had a weapon and demanded money. But when the clerk refused to give him any money, the man fled away in a vehicle. The police were called, and while they were at the gas bar investigating, the man returned to apologize to the clerk for trying to rob him. He was arrested on the spot. So why do we do things like that? Why do we say sorry so much? Well, there's some discussions as to why that is. For some, it's seen as a cultural thing. That is, we have been raised in a society where it is the norm for people to apologize every time a minor transgression happens. And when you're raised that way, you are likely to follow the norm and do it yourself. That's one idea. For others, it has to do with conflict. Canadians, on the whole, do not like conflict. And we especially do not like being the instigators of conflict. We do not want to do anything to create conflict. So to say sorry may help to diffuse a potential conflict. When someone bumps into us, we say sorry automatically. But why do we do that? Well, some think it's because we want to let the other person know that we're not upset, to let them know that we're not injured, at least not too badly, and to suggest that we both move on and forget that this even happened. It's kind of like a social agreement between us in order to diffuse any potential conflict. The fact is, it's usually the person who didn't do anything wrong who says sorry first. To acknowledge that although they might be upset, they aren't going to take it personally. Saying, hey buddy, watch where you're going, would escalate the situation. That's not something we as Canadians want to do, at least for most of us. However, there are always exceptions. Did you know that we say sorry so much that there is an apology act? Most provinces have one. Ontario passed our apology act in 2009. This act basically says that it allows the communication of expressions of sorrow or regret without worrying that the comments can later be used against us in a civil court. Basically, it's saying sorry doesn't mean you're admitting to being at fault. Canadians also don't see saying sorry as something that will cause us a loss of face or a loss of respect, as it's perceived in some other countries. It's merely a way to ensure that we keep the peace. Maybe that's why we make good peacekeepers. There are times, however, when we will not back down from a fight, especially if someone else initiates it, and if it is something that we have strong feelings about. We're not wimps or pushovers. No matter the reason that we say sorry, it is something that we do almost by reflex, and saying sorry as a reflex for some people is seen as essentially a meaningless courtesy. Well, saying sorry as often as we do may at times be seen by some as a meaningless courtesy, but it is a forgiveness of sorts, isn't it? Well, not according to Wikipedia, which defines forgiveness in part as the intentional and voluntary process by which a victim undergoes a change in feelings and attitudes regarding an offense and overcomes negative emotions such as resentment and vengeance, however justified that might be. So first of all, it is intentional. It is not a reflex or a meaningless courtesy. It is something that you intentionally do. And then it's a voluntary thing. So it has to be your willingness to forgive. It can't be mandated or demanded, or it's not true forgiveness. If forgiveness is intentional and voluntary, what is it not? Well, first of all, it's not an automatic response. It's not condoning an action and failing to see it as wrong and therefore not even understanding the need for forgiveness. It's not making excuses for an action and therefore not holding anyone responsible. It's also not forgetting or removing the awareness of the offense from our consciousness. Forgiveness is also not pardoning, like it is in the legal system. Two different things. Nor is forgiveness the same as reconciliation. So if these are the things that forgiveness is not, what then is it? Well, most world religions include teachings on the nature of forgiveness. The benefits of forgiveness have been explored in religious thought, in social science, and even in medicine. Forgiveness is an important part of being emotionally and physically healthy and happy. Forgiveness may be considered simply in the terms of the person who forgives, including forgiving yourself, in terms of the person who is forgiven, or even in terms of the relationship between the forgiver and the person forgiven. In practical terms, though, it may be necessary for the offender to offer some sort of acknowledgement, an apology, or even just asking for forgiveness in order for the person who was wrong to believe that they are able to forgive. Most of all, though, forgiveness is easier said than done. In most situations, forgiveness is granted without any expectation of restorative justice or without any response on the part of the offender. For example, you may forgive a person who you no longer are in contact with, or they may even have died by the time you forgave them. C.S. Lewis wrote, "Last week while at prayer, I suddenly discovered that I had finally forgiven someone that I had been trying to forgive for 30 years. I have no explanation, my friends, for this kind of thing, except to turn to the words of the Apostle Paul, written over 2,000 years ago, saying, all of this is from God." Where does that get us? The image of debt in the Lord's Prayer and in the Bible, and even in our world, is helpful in considering the meaning of forgiveness. When someone is in our debt, we have power over them. To forgive is to give up that power. So forgiving is a form of giving. True forgiveness is without conditions, and then we no longer hold something back in our relationship with that person. Notice we use words like hold in expressions like hold a grudge. Holding back is destructive both for others and for ourselves. That's what Joseph's brothers faced in our Genesis reading from this morning. They worried that Joseph held a grudge and would pay them back for all the wrongs that they did to him, hating him, plotting to kill him, selling him off into slavery, and then telling their father that they had found his coat of many colors covered in blood, letting their father think his youngest son was dead. That's a significant amount of wrongdoing that Joseph may not have forgiven them for. But when asked for forgiveness from his brothers, Joseph wept. The brothers asked for forgiveness and then threw themselves on Joseph's mercy, offering to be his slaves. Well, Joseph didn't take them up on their offer, but forgave them, telling them that they had nothing to fear. And Joseph renewed his relationship with them and with their families. But it was a time of tears and heartache. Forgiveness is about relationships, and it is costly. It is costly to the one who forgives, as well as to the one who is forgiven, because it means giving up something. It is costly because it means acknowledging the need for forgiveness, and that means turning away from the lies and the pretending. It means allowing ourselves to be vulnerable, allowing ourselves to be loved. It means facing up to ourselves, whether we are the forgiver or the forgiven. Many times, we even hold back what we are resentful and angry about. We don't let others know what they have done or not done, what they have said or not said that has hurt us. They don't know that they have hurt us. We don't give them the chance to change their behavior or explain their thoughts or circumstances. It's easier to hold on to our resentment and anger than to try to talk to the one we think who has wronged us in some way. When we hang on to resentment and bitterness and refuse to forgive, we do nothing to the one who has wronged us. Rather, we are punishing ourselves with increased blood pressure, chronic tension, stomach acid, loss of relationship, among other things. But forgiveness is no easy thing to give. It can be a painful road, but it does lead to freedom. Forgiveness is not forgetting. To forgive is not to deny the pain or the wrongness of an act. Forgiveness is not weakness. It is not passive. It is not gutless. Forgiving and being forgiven is part of being human. It may take time. For C.S. Lewis, it took 30 years. It may take healing, and it may even be one-sided, but it is worth the effort. According to the scripture in Matthew, we are to forgive unconditionally anyone who begs for mercy. But how many times? Well, today's scripture talks about keeping score in forgiveness. Peter asked that question: how many times do I forgive a brother or a sister who hurts me? Well, the Jewish community in that time in history were expected to forgive three times. So one, two, three. A small enough number that you can keep track of how many times you have forgiven someone. Sort of like three swings and you're out of luck, out of chances, out of being forgiven. So it's easy when the number is three to keep score. Peter then is actually being generous in his suggestion of seven times, considering what his society expects. Seven times is more than double what is expected. One, two, three, four, five, six, seven. Still a small enough number that we can still keep score. Jesus then ups the ante to 70 times seven, or in some translations, 77 times. So do the math using the translation that Mary read to you this morning. 70 times seven is 490 times. Not so easy to keep score when it's 490 times. But I don't believe that Jesus is being literal here, but rather saying that to forgive is to be without limits. Keeping score in matters of forgiveness is not only ridiculous, it is harmful. Harmful not just for the person we are resentful and angry at, but harmful to ourselves. Jesus suggests with his story that if you keep a ledger, if you insist on what is due to you, you will always end up with the short end of the stick, so to speak. Clayton Smith writes, it best, I think, when he says 490. This is the number, if you have to have a number, but it is an impossible number, completely unthinkable. Jesus uses an absurd exaggeration. What it means is this: forgive your brothers and sisters beyond your ability to keep track. If you are keeping track, it is not really forgiveness at all. You may seem to be kind, but keeping track simply means that you're waiting for your neighbor to cross some line. Generously drawn, perhaps, but a line nonetheless. Beyond the line, you are no longer willing to forgive. Jesus calls into question that entire game. If you count, if you keep count, it is not called forgiveness. Jesus also suggests in this story that if you remember how much mercy God has shown you, if you allow the incredible wonder of his grace and his forgiveness to fill your mind and to fill your heart, if you realize the incredible mercy God has poured out on you, then you will in turn be able to forgive others as often as need be, from your heart. Thanks be to God. Amen.
This anthem that we are about to perform for you comes with a small Latin lesson attached, which I'm not sorry about. The three Latin words you will hear repeated by the singers is Soli Deo Gloria, which translates to God alone be the glory. This is a bit of an in-joke with musicians, as it was frequently signed off on pieces by Bach to indicate that though he wrote beautiful music, it was all for the glory of God. And so you will hear repeated in this anthem, Soli Deo Gloria, to God alone be the glory.
Soli Deo, Soli Deo.
Praise God.
Let us pray. Almighty and merciful God, from whom comes all that is good, we praise you for all your mercies, for your goodness that has created us, your grace that has sustained us, your wisdom that has challenged us, your patience that has borne with us, and your love that has redeemed us. Help us to love you and all your children, and to be thankful for all your gifts, by serving you and delighting to do your will. Creator, we make our petitions, prayers, and requests to you for all people, as the Church has always done throughout its history. Today, we especially remember the refugee family newly arrived, families struggling with anxiety, the homes, family, and friends. For everyone missing getting together with friends and family, and all others who are struggling with the changes this pandemic has brought to their lives. We recognize also that we have been persecutors of others, of people different from ourselves, of different traditions and denominations, of different faiths and of no faith. Here we create the space to listen to your people whom you know, yet who remain silent to us. So give us ears to hear their story of persecution in our world today, and give us the courage to act. You are the one who brings all of us together across the world. May our doors be open, our hearts be welcoming, our faith encouraging, and our prayers heard in peace, for peace, in Jesus' name. Amen. In our worship, we praise God and give God thanks for our gifts. In gratitude for God's generosity, we share God's abundance with one another. We thank God that he does not judge us by the perfection of our actions, but rather by our readiness to live boldly in faith. Hear us now as we pray. Most gracious and generous God,
in whom we live and move and have our being,
accept the gifts we have offered to you through pre-authorized remittance, e-transfer, Canada Helps, PayPal, check, talent, or time.
Symbols of love and earthly toil, signs of our praise and gratitude.
Accept them, bless them, and us.
We ask it in Jesus' name. Amen.
That what pause was for it to get from the back to the front, right?
Yes.
So now we're going to sing One More Step Along the World I Go.
Traveling along with you, and it's from the old I try.
Go in peace, love, and care for one another in the name of Jesus the Christ. Show forgiveness to one another as in Christ you have been shown forgiveness. And may the power of God save you from all danger. May the mercy of Jesus Christ fill you with love. And may the Holy Spirit uphold you and direct you day by day, both now and forevermore. Amen.
Sing, Amen, Amen, we praise your name, O Lord.